depiction. This is a description of what has happened over and over again. It means that a Marxist analysis says a transition that does not involve a fundamental change in the organization of the surplus is not what Marx, at least, was talking about. We went through the first day of this class, the five different kinds of class structure in Marxian theory. Remember? The communist, the ancient, the slave, the feudal, and the capitalist. For Marx, a revolution means a transition from one kind of class structure to another. The switches from capitalism, private to state, don't involve that. There is no change in the organization. There's a change in the personnel. Instead of private individuals elected by shareholders who run a capitalist corporation, it's now state officials elected by the party or the government. That's interesting. That has consequences. But we haven't changed the structure. We've just changed who occupies the positions in the structure. If you have two parents and something happens to them and the society puts two other people in the same position your parents were in, it'll be different. But you haven't changed the structure of the family. You've changed the people. Here in America now, we're in the process of making sure that corporations, boards of directors, have a certain number of people of the female persuasion and of the non-white orientation. If you're expecting this to have a fundamental change in the way these corporations operate, you have been waiting and you will be waiting a really long time. You've changed the personnel, but you haven't changed the structure into which those persons are fixed. And the rules of that structure will much more likely change those people than they will change those rules. That's been the pattern all the way through. Let's turn then and use this in another way, the same apparatus. What would be a trade union strategy? What should a trade union do? This is a very old question. A trade union is an organization designed to represent and advance the interests of workers. Okay, what are they, the interests of workers, that is? Well, that's a theoretical question. And how you approach the world shapes how you answer that question. Now, this isn't like the answer or the correct answer. There are different answers. Now, if you're a Marxist, what would be your answer using this apparatus? Well, from this perspective, the problem of a worker in a capitalist system is that he, she is exploited. They're in a structural situation in which, together with other workers, they produce a surplus they don't get, whose distribution they don't participate in. They are ripped off, alienated, we've been through all that. So if you're going to advance the interests of the worker, the Marxist idea is, hey, we need to get the worker out of that situation. And the way to do that is to change the organization of production. Production should be organized so that the workers are not ripped away from the fruits of their labor, are not excluded from appropriating and distributing the surplus the way they are under capitalism. What a worker needs is to be a full participant in production. He or she needs to have a particular function, is her job, but that job ought to include participating in the appropriation and distribution of the surplus, because that's what a worker needs, that's what our society needs, and that's what the union is going to fight for. That's one perspective. That is not the perspective of the labor movement. And it rarely has been. Here's an alternative view, not right or wrong, alternative view. Workers are people who sell something. Just like a peddler sells rags, or a fruit person sells bananas, workers sell their capacity to work. And the job of the union is to get the best price for what you sell. Just like coffee producers get together to get the best price for coffee when they sell it, workers get together to get the best price for their labor. power when they sell. And that's the job of the union. And the union should go around and bargain collectively with the employer to get the highest wage. That's another perspective. But notice, because I'm a partisan here, I'm not going to give equal time or, you know, persuasive effort to both sides. Just warn you. All right, so the union perspective that has been dominant, the collective bargaining get higher wages, is a perspective in which the reorganization of the surplus does not appear. It's not there. It's not that it's a lower priority. It's not there. One more time. It's not there. And for the Marxist, fighting for higher wages is horrific. And let me give you again a metaphor to play with how horrible it is. And I'm playing with your sensitivities because I want to drive the point home that it's horrible. I'm just telling you about it beforehand. Suppose you were present 150 years ago when the United States had legally allowed slavery. African American people were over here as slaves, blah, blah, they were slaves. And suppose you were upset by slavery, the same way I assume you were upset by the conditions of working people in capitalism. Then you would have noticed right away that in the United States there were two kinds of opposition to slavery. The majority, most of the time, had the following view. It's awful that the slave is poorly fed. It's awful that the slaves are poorly housed. It's awful that the slaves have their families ripped apart. It's awful, it's awful, it's awful. Solution? There should be intervention to make sure slaves get a decent diet and decent housing and decent clothing and can keep their families. And then there was another part who said, what? The problem isn't that the slave should be fed better. The problem is he's a slave. And as long as you improve the conditions of the slave, but he still remains somebody else's property, it's only a matter of time until the conditions of that slave master make him take away what you forced him to give. The only security for the slave not to be treated as slaves were is if you get rid of the institution. You make it illegal for one person to be the property of another. And eventually in the United States, for a lot of complicated reasons, that was done. 14th Amendment of the United States Constitution, which has, of course, an exception to it. I always say that you're all aware. Slavery is outlawed except, the Constitution says, in prisons. That's what it said. Never been repealed. So in the United States, it is legal in prison to have slavery, which we do. And since we have more people per population in prison than any other country on earth, slavery is alive and well in the United States. But it's behind bars where you don't have to look at it. Okay. The Marxist argument says the same thing about capitalism that I just went through with slavery. There are two kinds of people who deal with the worker's plight in capitalism. Those who want the worker to be better fed, better housed, better clothed, that's a trade union movement. That's the socialists. They want to improve more services, higher wages, subsidized health care. And then there's another group, like me, said, wait, stop! The problem isn't how well you feed the exploited worker. The problem is he's exploited, so we need a law. Not the 14th Amendment, whatever the next amendment number would be. What is it? Someone else was 20-something. I mean, none of you knows either. Tells you a lot. Anyway, here's the amendment. No person, like the 14th Amendment says, no person can be the property of another. No person can exploit another. It's a very short amendment. You can arrange anything you want, it's just nobody can produce surplus for somebody else. If you produce a surplus, you will participate in appropriate industry. That's it. By the way, that would constrain production. Sure it is. We constrain production all the time. For example, if in the middle of a production process, I come over to you and smack you in the face, I get arrested. You can't do that in production. I can't threaten to fire you unless you have sex with me. Can't do it. I can't beat you around the head with a stick. Can't do it. I can't demand you go into a dangerous situation. Can't do it. And here's another one. You can't exploit someone. You can work together with them. You can have a cooperative enterprise. You can have all kinds of enterprises. You just can't have exploitation. This would take 10 minutes to work out. But there's nothing complicated here. If you understand the theory of surplus, then all of this makes sense. But fortunately, by keeping the concept of surplus away from people, you reduce the number of people who think like this and reach such conclusions. Okay, moving right along. I'm now going to give you yet another example in a completely different domain. I've hinted at this before, but now I want to spend a little time at it. Enterprises is what we've been talking about, organizing the surplus in an enterprise. But enterprises are not the only place in capitalist societies where surplus gets produced and distributed. And in Marxian theory, you are obligated, it's the logic of the theory, if you're going to stay with the theory, you're obligated to ask the question, are there places in society other than enterprises, because we know we've done the work there, surpluses are produced and distributed in and by enterprises, we've done that. Are there other places where work is done by people, they use their brains and muscles to transform materials from nature into goods and services? Is work being done? And if so, does Marxian theory enable you to detect that some people are producing a surplus? Because if you can find that, then you need to ask the Marxian questions. Who's producing the surplus? Who's getting the surplus? How are they distributing it? And how is it all working out? Fast forward. I've done that work with other people about, say, American society. And we've discovered the following location in society, not in any enterprise, where work is done. And the one I'm going to talk about is, there are actually several, but what I'm going to talk about is the household. The household, where mom and pop, or mom and mom, or I don't want to be very careful, where everybody is, are living together. Okay? With children, without children, the household. Does work occur in the household? Of course it does. Food, raw material, is transformed by pots and pans and ovens into finished products, meals. Dirty rooms are treated with machinery to make them into something else, clean rooms. Clothes are mended, sicknesses are healed, all kinds of work is done. Now we use Marxism. Let's see, is this work organized such that there's a surplus produced? And if so, by whom, for whom, what's going on? Okay, let me answer the question. And if any of you are interested, I can give you readings where you can go into this in great detail. In any case, the household. Yes, we're going to start with the traditional household in America. It should be called traditional because that tradition is old, but it's the old image. The husband, the father who goes out to work, the wife who stays at home, cares for the children, etc. Let's see how that household, which is still maintained as a kind of model of what life is when it's good, sort of Sarah Palin imagery. The husband goes out to work. What does the wife do? She works in the household. She uses her brains and muscles to transform nature by means of machines and equipment to produce goods and services. She cooks meals, she makes the bed, she cleans the clothes, she produces the garden, she cares for the children, all of that. Now, let's see. Does she produce a surplus? Well, let's see. When she makes dinner,